So this morning, happy Mother's Day. I was reading, there's a guy that I follow on Twitter. He's called Unappreciated Pastor, and he's got a picture of Rodney Dangerfield, and I think I identify with him a little bit. And he said something this morning I thought I'd share with you. You know, a lot of times in churches, they used to give awards for the mother with the most kids. And of course, we'd have a toss-up here with some of the mothers here, and then we'd have, you know, gifts for the youngest mother, the oldest mother. What they're suggesting now is that we give the award to the mother with the most Facebook friends. So. And I figured somebody would take the credit for that. Are y'all glad you came to church this morning? Amen. We appreciate so much all of the ministries that took the weekend and helped us to greet folks and to give us some times of fellowship. And we've got hospitality here today. Hospitality Life Church is just second to none. I'm telling you, you guys just do an awesome job at that. And we are so appreciative of all of that. And for the media team that keeps things running upstairs, thank you guys for all that you do and getting that stuff together and ready. And so we're going to preach this morning. If you want a printed outline, if you put your hand up, Manny will be right there with you. Are you going to bring him a burrito too, brother, or just an outline? Burritos are gone. Okay, too late for that one. Anyway, if you like an outline, Manny will get that. We're going to preach to you today a message that we're calling Forever. Everybody say Forever. How many of you have heard songs that have the word forever in it? I'm thinking of a lot of worship songs, you know, forever God is faithful, forever God is strong. That comes from the Psalms where the psalmist said, give thanks to the Lord, our God and King, his love endures forever. I think Carrie Job has a song called Forever. And then, of course, the secular world, they got their songs too. I was thinking about that, and I got on Google and I said, give me some songs with the word forever, and there was actually a website that had 100 songs with the word forever in it. It's like we're consumed with that. I mean, everybody wants things that will last. I do. I don't like things that don't last. I mean, it's tough when things don't last. Some of the songs they had were songs that I recognized. Forever and Ever, Amen. Anybody ever heard of that? How about this one? Some of you won't recognize this. There's one called Forever Young. That didn't work out very good, did it? I mean, they're everywhere. The whole world sings about the idea of forever and having love that lasts forever and having relationships that last forever because there's something in our heart about forever. And I want to give you a scripture as a launching pad for the message today and show you that even in the New Testament, some of Jesus' disciples were thinking about forever. This is in Matthew chapter 17. It'll be on the board. But in Matthew chapter 17 and verse number 1, the Bible says, 6 days later, Jesus took Peter and the two brothers, James and John, and led them up a high mountain to be alone. As the men watched, Jesus' appearance was transformed so that his face shone like the sun and his clothes became as white as light. Suddenly, Moses and Elijah appeared and began talking with Jesus. Peter exclaimed, Lord, it's wonderful for us to be here. If you want, I'll make 3 shelters as memorials, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. But even as he spoke, a bright cloud overshadowed them. And a voice from the cloud said, this is my dearly beloved son who brings me great joy. Listen to him. And the disciples were terrified and fell face down to the ground. We can say today that this story represents the disciples seeing something that they hadn't seen before. And I want you to know that the God who is alive is not like us. The God who is alive is different than you might expect him to be. And many people have a mental ascent of who God is, but if you ever get a chance to see God in His glory, it will change you. God is not like us. He is so altogether unlike us that the Bible calls Him holy. And in this moment, Peter, James, and John saw something. And it excited them, and it terrified them. I remember Steve Brown used to sing this on the radio. He said, if you've never been in the presence of Jesus and been excited, then you've never been in the presence of Jesus. And then he also said, if you've never been in the presence of God and been afraid, then you've never been in the presence of God. And both things are true. God is a good God, but He's also an awesome God, and He's totally unlike us. And so, in this case, we see Jesus taking three of His inner circle disciples off to a retreat into the mountains. And in this retreat, Jesus gives them a glimpse of forever. As you read the story about Jesus' countenance changing, transformed, the word is the same Greek word that we get the word metamorphosis from. It means to be changed. His countenance was changed. He looked differently. The disciples got a chance to see something that was more real than the physical reality of which they were living in. The old-timers called this the transfiguration of Jesus. It's when these disciples saw with their own eyes that Jesus was more than just a man. God is not the man upstairs. He is holy God, and Jesus is the Son of God. And in this particular situation, the spokesman, which was always Peter, he speaks up. He wants to stay there. He says, this is great. He says, this is a moment I want to experience forever. I want to stay here. In fact, Jesus, I'll just make three shelters, one for all three of us, all three of you, and we'll just hang out here and enjoy forever together. And then the Father spoke. Another cloud shows up. Can you imagine? Put yourself, I want you to use your imagination for a minute. Put yourself on a mountain retreat and seeing what these guys saw, and then feeling the fear and the excitement and thinking, this is really good. I want to stay here. I don't want to ever leave. I want to be here. And then picture another cloud showing up and a voice from heaven speaking. Can I just ask you something today, Bible believer? Do you believe this actually happened like this? Do you believe that God can speak that way? Our God is a limitless God. There's nothing He cannot do. And when Jesus is here, God many times was proving the fact that Jesus was His Son and that Jesus was the one sent by God Almighty. And in this case, the Father said, this is My beloved Son. Listen to Him. And then it was over. And when the voice spoke, the disciples hit the dust for fear. This story is a great story of something that I can relate to, even though I've never seen that type of brightness and I've never seen or heard the voice of God in that audible way. But I have lived long enough to know that there are some days that I just wish those days could go on forever. Have you? Have you ever had bad days? Days that you thought, I just can't wait till this day is over because this day's been difficult from the front to the end. Amen? But then there are some days where it seems like today is just the perfect day. It's the day that I wish I could live in forever. I think we all have those moments. And I thought about what that moment means to me. Because it was in one of these moments that God spoke to me this idea about what's in our heart wanting this forever experience. The perfect day could be described like this. Like you had no trouble getting to sleep the night before, When you woke up, nothing hurt. And you woke up on time the first time. Breakfast or coffee was ready and somebody else brought it to you. The weather was perfect. Your car had plenty of gas. The headlights work. The stoplights were green. Traffic was out of the way. When you got home later that morning, you got to watch 3 hours uninterrupted of the Food Network. Some of you are like, yeah. Can I be honest with you? I don't understand that. I see it everywhere, but I don't get it. And so the kids got along all day. The baby didn't cry. Your spouse or significant other was in a great mood and spent the day serving you. The electric company called to say you paid too much last month, so this month is free. The bank called and said, concerning the overdrawn check, no problem. We got you covered. You found $100 on the sidewalk. And you discovered the breaking news that donuts are now a healthy food choice. You went to dinner that night, the restaurants were not busy, and you were the 1,000th customer, so it was free. Perfect day. Perfect day is filled with moments that make you think, I wish I could just stay here forever. On a more serious side, it might look like this. And as I share this one, this was my morning yesterday morning, and I just want to take a second and testify to you. Last Thursday night, some people came to this church and sat here in this church, and about a dozen people prayed for an hour and a half and just sought the Lord. And it was one of those sweet moments that actually I could say, I just wish this day could go on forever, because we were in the presence of God. And the people in that prayer circle began to pray, and I noticed that some of them began to pray for me. And they prayed about what I would need on Saturday. It may be hard for you to understand, but in the realm of spiritual warfare, spiritual leaders are the first ones to get attacked by the enemy. The enemy is very real. God is very real, but the enemy is very real. And the enemy will never stop going after God's servants. If you decide that you're going to serve the Lord, do not be surprised when the enemy comes after you. And one of the enemy's biggest tools is the tool of intimidation, fear, discouragement, and depression. And every Saturday, because that's the start of the weekend, I deal with the enemy's attacks upon me emotionally. And so Thursday night, amongst the prayer circle, they began to pray for me. And they prayed that I would have a restful morning and a great morning and a good experience spending time with God. I just want to testify that my Saturday morning, in answer to my people's prayers, was spent on my back deck studying the Word. With the shade and the breeze was cool and the coffee was good and God refreshed my spirit and got me ready for the day. Thank God for answered prayers. And in those kind of moments, I just think, and I always think this, I wish it could be like this forever. Do you guys know what I'm talking about? It might be like in the middle of the cool water in the pool underneath the warm sun. And it might be in the middle of singing that song that ignites your spirit in the presence of a congregation that is singing praise to God, and you think, I don't want to ever leave this. Back in the 90s, when my children were young, one of the things that I did every year, several times a year, was I would go with a group of guys to a conference that was called Promise Keepers. And in the early days of Promise Keepers, there'd be 30,000 to 40,000 guys that would show up in stadiums around the country, and they would sing to the Lord, and they would sing and they would party and they would celebrate because our God is a good God. And in those moments, I didn't want to leave. I can remember taking my two young sons with me. You would think children don't want to be in an area, in a place where all day Friday and all day Saturday, all you do is sing and pray and praise and preach. But I want to tell you, my kids love going to those things. And we'd get together and be me and my sons and all these other men lifting up their hands, worshiping God. And I want to tell you something, those were the times I wish could just go on forever. I can still remember them. It could be in the middle of doing the service that God has called you to do, because there's nothing like obeying God and the peace that comes. The perfect day could be spending the day with that special person in your life. It could be when the grandchild walks up to you with their hands up and says, "Granddad, pick me up." The perfect day could be the moment when you first saw your newborn. What is it for you there? What is it for you today? What does that perfect day look like? That day when you think, "I just wish I could stay here forever." But you know something? When Peter said to Jesus, "Lord, it's good to be here. I wish we could stay here forever." Jesus said, "You don't know what you're saying." And today, when we expect this life to be something that we will experience on a good way every day forever, we're simply not knowing what we're saying. The great things that happen to us on the earth are reminders of the eternity that is to follow. The good news today is, for someone like me, the day is coming when I'll get to be with 30,000 guys times 10. Times 10, times 10, in a place where we'll never have to go home again. In a place where the singing doesn't have to stop. In a place where the loved ones can be together forever and we can experience the eternal day forever. That day's coming. And my purpose for the message today is to give you Christians, mothers, fathers, men and women, children, some hope that life is going to turn someday in a very positive way for you. Because that's what Jesus has purchased for you. Let me give you three thoughts about forever before I describe what forever looks like for the believer. First, temporary can never be forever. I have to square it away that not every day is going to be perfect for me. And if you're always looking for that next thing that's going to make something worthwhile and you're looking for it here in this life, you're going to always be disappointed. Everything on this side is temporary, except what you do in the name of Jesus. That lasts forever. Peter confused temporary with forever. He had that backwards. He had it confused. Somebody says, "Well, why couldn't God make it where we live in that perfect day now?" God did. He put us in the garden and we killed it with our sin. You know what's making your life tough? It's not God. It's sin. Sin is a great disruptor. Sin is what causes so much trouble. And ladies and gentlemen, if you follow sin, your forever is going to be way different than those who follow Jesus. Temporary can never be forever. And then the second thing is, we all have a strong desire for forever. All of us do. You ever heard an atheist talk and say, "Well, once you die, it's just over. I'm not worried about it"? The atheist is in denial of the forever desire. The Bible says that God, in Ecclesiastes 3:11, has planted eternity in the human heart. God has planted that desire in you. That's what we're looking for. That's why we write songs about forever. That's why we love to think about forever. And the last thought is that we were created to live forever. The Bible even shows in Romans chapter 8 and verse 19 that to creation waits an eager expectation for the children of God to be revealed. You know what that means? Everything you see in nature is waiting for forever. Everything. Everything we know today is temporary. Everything that we put our time into today is temporary. Everything that we get stressed out about is temporary. And everything good that comes from God is eternal. Oh, I wish I could get you to see it today. I wish I could get you to see it. Because you've got two contrasting things. You have the enemy and his world, and then you have God and his forever, and the two aren't even close. I'm reminded of what Jesus said that narrow is the way that leads to this forever, and broad is the way, and many will find this forever. And I think about the contrast, what the world offers. I mean, what does the world offer? The world offers pleasure. It's temporary. The world offers excitement. It's temporary. The world offers things that seem to promise us prestige and power and influence and money and all the things this world provides, and then one day we die and it's gone. Temporary. What God offers us over on this side. Jesus said it's a narrow way to get in, and few find it. But when you get on this side, everything that is promised to you is something you can enjoy forever. But you're never going to get in this side while worshiping this side. That's why the Bible calls it repentance. We repent of our sin and we turn to Jesus. That means we say no to this world and say yes to this world. But I want to testify to you today that when you say yes to this world, God comes in and brings his peace to your life. And everything that he promises, he fulfills. And one day we get to experience him forever. What does it look like? What does forever look like for the Christian? Have you ever thought about heaven? Have you ever thought about, what goes on there? I mean, what comes to mind? Maybe some of you, when I say heaven, the thing that comes to mind is a little angel or something sitting on a cloud playing a harp. And we think of heaven as kind of abstract, like we can't really get our mind around it. We don't really get it. And when we're struggling with the world and we're struggling with stress and we're struggling with the problems of the enemy, and then we start thinking about what's to come, we really can't put our fingers on it. Well, the Bible says some things about heaven. Maybe you don't know about these things. Maybe today we can figure out what is so good about heaven. What does forever look like for the Christian? Point number one, the Savior is in forever. You know who's there? I mean, some of you could say, you know, and I've read this morning, you know, happy Mother's Day to my mother in heaven, and that's very appropriate. And mom might be there. Grandma might be there. Some other loved one might be there. But what is it that makes heaven heaven? First and foremost, the Savior is there. Does this mean anything to you today? You see, if you're in love with Babylon and this world, that might not mean very much to you. But I want to tell you, someone who has been bogged down and chained down by this world, when the mighty Savior showed up and broke every chain and planted you in this kingdom, it's going to mean something when you see him over there. The Bible says in Revelation 21, I heard a loud shout from the throne saying, look, God's home is now among his people. Think about that. God's home is now among his people. You know what that means? That means we're going to be at home with him. We're going to see the literal, physical Jesus. We're going to be there with him. You see God's home, and then you see God's heart. It says he will live with them and they will be his people. God himself will be with them. And what's he going to do? Look, notice this. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. He'll wipe it away. We live in this world and we deal with so much sadness. In fact, the amount of suffering that's in the world today is shocking. If you're paying attention to what's going on in the world and how much pain there is in the world, if you take the idea of the Savior out of the world, we are hopeless. And we struggle against the enemy, and we struggle against pain, and we struggle with loss, and with mourning, and with disease. But one day, when we get to our forever, our Savior himself will dry the eyes of the people who have suffered. Ladies and gentlemen, we see his heart. We see God's home, we see his heart, we see his happiness. The Bible says, listen, there will be no more death. I mean, I can't describe anything more painful than death. It's the thing that all of mankind is afraid of. But in our forever, it will be a thing of the past. No more death, no more sorrow, no more crying, no more pain. All these things are gone forever. The sadness and aloneness and depression and discouragement will fade in the presence of our Savior. What about our forever? Our Savior is in forever. Now, where the Savior is, things change. Where the Savior shows up, people respond. When Jesus was transfigured, at least one of the group began to talk. There's nothing recorded about James and John, but Peter was always talking, so he always got recorded. Peter was one of those guys like, there he goes again. And Peter was talking about how good it is to be with God, but then when God began to speak, all of them hit the ground. You see, where the Savior is, things begin to change and people respond. And in heaven, in forever, not only is the Savior there, but there is singing in forever. They're singing. The Bible says they sang in a mighty chorus. Worthy is the Lamb who was slaughtered to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing. Man, that's a worship song. I want to tell you something. There is nobody in heaven that's going to be worshiping like this. Well, I don't like this song. A little loud in here. Yeah, she didn't start the song off right. Amen? Hey, I just want to ask y'all, what y'all come in here for today anyway? You think Jesus was here or what? Huh? Oh, but Pastor, I can't sing. Oh, I didn't see that was a prerequisite. Yeah, the pastor falls down. That'd be great. Can we cut that out up there? They never help me on that stuff. I imagine that would be shared everywhere, wouldn't it? I mean, I didn't know it was a prerequisite. Well, you know, I can't sing, you know. I don't know the song. I don't know the tune. The tune is, there is power in the name of Jesus. How about this? This one's real hard to remember. You are good. I mean, I just wonder. You see, people who have met the Savior, when he shows up, they respond. And in heaven, let me tell you what's going on in heaven. There's nobody going, I hope they don't hear me singing. Amen? Are y'all getting this? Are we still friends? Huh? I mean, when you get in the presence of the Savior, you know, here's the thing. Too many people are self-conscious. I don't want anybody to hear me sing. I don't want to see, oh, man, I don't want to see anyone to see me do this. When you get in the presence of the Savior, the aspect of worship means we're not self-conscious, we're God-conscious. And if God says, stand up, I got news. It's time to stand up. If God says, sit down, it's time to sit down. If God begins to speak and it's terrifying, you know what's going to happen to us? Boom, we're going to hit the dust. You see, in forever, all of those chains are gone. We just come together and we sing. And the Bible says that worthy is the lamb that was slaughtered. You know what that means? That means we're praising him. We're singing to him. You are worthy. Can I ask the church today, is Jesus worthy of glory, power, honor, riches, wisdom, strength? Is he worthy of your praise today? You see, too much self-consciousness. Oh, I've had a bad day. Really? I mean, here's what's wrong. If you let what happens out there determine what happens in here, you're going to come in with a broken spirit. You're going to go out the same. But I can tell you, if you will forget what happened out there, and when you get in here amongst God's people and decide we're going to focus on him, God will lift your spirit today. And then you know what we get to do? We get to experience a little bit of forever. We get to get a little taste of it. I mean, this is good. You know, isn't it interesting? I've been in a lot of sporting events. I've been in a lot of pep rallies. You know, a guy gets on third base and somebody's up the bat and the organist is going, you know, playing the little tune. I wish Luke would be up here and just play that. That'd be a great backdrop, don't you think? You know, somebody hits a home run, what happens? Fireworks goes off. Somebody wins a game, the whole stadium starts to sing. And we are the saved, the redeemed of the Lord, and we're just like, Seems to me like maybe we ought to get to know who God is. Because when you get a hold of God, big stuff happens. There's no possible way to be in the presence of Jesus without being moved. And in forever, they are singing. Not only are they singing, but point number three, there is serenity in forever. Who needs some serenity today? Can I tell you something? All of this world over here can never give you peace. Tried it. Already did. And I've talked to hundreds of people that still thought they could make this world give them peace, and it never worked. It never has, and it never will. The only way that you're going to get peace in your life is come out of this world and get into God's forever. That's the only way. I mean, think about what characterizes your life? I mean, think about all of the dysfunction that's in our life. There's anxiety going on in the world today at a level that we haven't seen ever on the planet. And many of us in this room deal with it right now. There's anxiety. There's stress. There's pressure. There's depression. There's discouragement. There's despondency. There's physical pain, chronic pain. Think about all of the stuff we deal with on a regular basis. And most of it comes from the fact that we don't have any peace in our mind. because we're going to the wrong place to get peace. You're not going to have any peace making more money. You're not going to have any peace going to sin, disobeying the word, disregarding what God says, participating in things that are destructive. And you might say, well, what is destructive? Anything that God says is sin is destructive, because at the end of sin, 100% of the time, is death. So how are you going to embrace a death culture and have peace of mind? I mean, think about the people that make it over here. Think about it. Think about the people that are popular and powerful and influential. They don't live any different than we do. Satan will allow a few folks to make big in the world to keep the rest of us reaching for it. And we reach for it all our life, and we never have it here. In heaven, in forever, there is serenity. The Bible says in Revelation 22:1-4, said that there was a river of the water of life, clear as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb. And it flowed down the center of the main street. On each side the river grew a tree of life bearing 12 crops of fruit and a fresh crop each month. The leaves were used for medicine to heal the nations. No longer will there be a curse on anything. For the throne of God and of the Lamb will be there, and his servants will worship him, and they will see his face, and his name will be written on their foreheads. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a picture of serenity, a river of life, calmness, peace, abundance, provision, healing. This is what God's got waiting for us. It's the thing that is so difficult for us to do in this world, to get the peace inside of us. But the Bible says that when we come to him and we pray about everything, the Bible says when we give everything to him, that the peace of God that passes understanding will be ours. And ladies and gentlemen, the day will come when we will end our time here and we will enter into eternity and we will forever be at peace. No more driving on busy highways, sitting forever at traffic lights, unreasonable deadlines and unreasonable bosses, noise from the neighbors or cars passing by, or dogs barking in the middle of the night waking you up. No more text messages that wake you up early in the morning. No more being late for appointments, being stood up by clients. No more paying taxes. This is my favorite. No more SpongeBob. Some of you just woke up. I have never, if you want to make me crazy, just put that on for 10 hours a day. No more headaches, body aches, toothaches, no more high blood pressure, low blood sugar, diabetes, disease, the anxiety, the pain, the temporary stress from the temporal life are gone forever, and they will never be resurrected. It will be a perfect day forever. Point number four, there is splendor in forever. Bible says in Revelation 21, the angel said, come with me, I will show you the bride, the wife of the Lamb. And he took me in the spirit to a great high mountain, showed me a holy city, Jerusalem, descending out of heaven from God. It shone with the glory of God and sparkled like a precious stone, like jasper, as clear as crystal. Have you ever seen a city like that? I love the house that God gave me to live in. It's not anything special, but it is to me. Some folks might say, well, that's not very much. It's very good and very appropriate, and it's great provision for me. But you know what? One day I'm going to move in a place much better than that, guys. The Bible says that in this scripture, the Bible talks about the Lamb. That's the splendor of redemption. That's Jesus. And it talks about the bride, the relationship, which is the wife, the church. And the Bible talks about the splendor of the city. You know how big this city is? This city that John saw coming down is 1,500 miles square. You want to see what it looks like on the map? It looks like this. almost completely covering the area of the United States and then extending 1,500 miles that way. That's out of our atmosphere. Somebody says, how's that going to happen? I don't know. But if God makes it happen, God will make it happen. 1,500 miles up means there's 600,000 floors. Please, God, don't put me on the top. Can you imagine a city like that? The Bible says it's sparkling, it's shiny. That's where we're going. The Savior's there, the singing is there, the serenity is there, the splendor is there, and the last thought is that the glory of the Lord will shine forever there. The Bible says in Revelation 21:22, I saw no temple in the city, for the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are its temple. And the city has no need of sun or moon, for the glory of God illuminates the city, and the Lamb is its light. Ladies and gentlemen, in this room, in this city, in this place that we're going, we're not going to need the sun or moon. Somebody's worried about when the sun goes out. It doesn't matter when our sun goes out, because the Son of God will never go out. Darkness is a characteristic of evil in the Bible. Night was feared in the ancient world, and John is telling us that in this place there's no more evil and there's no more fear. Hey, you're not ever going to have to be afraid anymore. Hey, you're not ever going to have to be around corrupt people anymore. You're not ever going to be done wrong anymore. You're not ever going to be criticized and persecuted and put down and stressed out and pressured out and depressed and discouraged and defeated. Those things are gone. We're going to live together in a place that will shine forever. And that's where we're going. Let me ask you something. Wouldn't you like to experience heaven forever? Forever is joyful because Jesus is there. Forever is joyful because family is there. Forever is peaceful because sin is not there. Forever is permanent because God is there. Forever is rest because our resurrected bodies are there. You know what that means? We can literally sing and worship and not get tired. I don't know if that means anything to y'all, but come on, some of y'all's lived a little while. Man, wouldn't it be great not to get tired anymore? Amen? Come on, I know somebody believes that. I know I do. Forever is hope because God's word puts it there, and forever is eternal because God is eternal, and I want you to know that Jesus invites you today to forever. Scripture says this, look, I am coming soon. Blessed are those who obey the words of the prophecy written in this book. And he says, the Spirit and the bride say, come. You might say, man, I'd love that forever. The Spirit says, come. The bride is the church. The church is here today. And what do we say to those thinking about this? Come. Say, how do I get that forever? I don't know how to get that. Look what he says. Let anyone who is thirsty come. Let anyone who desires drink freely from the water of life. It just comes down to this. Do you want to live forever with the Lord Jesus Christ? If so, come.